May I welcome everyone to the sixth meeting of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. We have apologies from committee member Jackie Bailey. May I ask everyone to turn off any electronic devices that may interfere with the smooth running of proceedings. The first item on the agenda is to take items 3 and 4 in private. Has the committee agreed that we'll take those items in private?
Agreed.
Now, we then move into our roundtable discussion with our guests who are here today from, I think, the big business sector is what we're looking at. We're interested in hearing as much as possible from our witnesses who have come as guests today. And may I say to them, if anyone wants to come in on the discussion, just to raise your hand, I will note that and bring you in as soon as I can. There's no need to switch on your microphone. That's dealt with by broadcasting. So we'll start, if I could ask for our guests to introduce themselves just by name and the organisation they represent. And I'll start to my right here with Graham Jones.
Graham Jones, CEO of Scottish Financial Enterprise.
David Lonsdale, Director of the Scottish Retail Consortium.
Eric Geddes, Communications Manager at Edinburgh Airport.
Gareth Williams, Head of Policy at the Scottish Council for Development and Industry.
David Williams, I'm the Public Affairs Director at the Scotch Whisky Association.
Mari Toombi, Assistant Director for Policy at CBI Scotland.
Right, thank you very much. Can I just ask about the apprenticeship levy and perhaps what our guests who are interested in that aspect of government policy will be looking for from the Scottish Government in this area? Perhaps I could start with David Lonsdale, if you wanted to comment on that.
Thank you. Thank you for that invitation, convener, and thanks for the opportunity, obviously, to be here today. Very happy to do so, and I'll follow up certainly if there's any questions afterwards with any information. In terms of the apprenticeship levy, our industry has a great record, I think, in terms of investing in staff. It's in our interest to do so. Obviously, our members have often extensive branch networks and deal with customers on a day-to-day basis and are dealing increasingly with technology, so they need to keep apprise of these and abreast of these things. In terms of the apprenticeship levy, we've been supportive of the need for more apprenticeships within industry. We wouldn't have started from this position if we were designing the apprenticeship levy. It came somewhat out of the blue, truth be told, from the Chancellor last year. Our, if you like, ask in a Scottish context is very much around allowing firms that contribute to the apprenticeship levy to be allowed to benefit directly from it going forward. And so that was one of the recommendations we put to the Finance Secretary in our budget submission a few weeks ago to him. So that's our sort of starting point, really, in terms of the apprenticeship levy. Obviously, it was designed at Westminster and came somewhat out of the blue, but we're keen to make sure that firms here in Scotland are able to benefit from it directly as well.
And what form would that benefit, in your view, take? Or might it take, if I might put it a bit more generally?
Well, we've put forward... published a position paper a couple of months ago, and we've responded to the Scottish Government's consultation on this issue. And essentially what we'd like is for firms in Scotland in the retail sector to be able to access that cash, ideally to spend on skills in the round, not necessarily apprenticeships, because obviously firms at different points in their history or in the development of their business require different types of skills going forward. So in one particular year, it might be apprenticeships, but in a subsequent year, it might be something different, because obviously the market is changing, particularly in the retail industry, given some of the structural challenges. So it's that ability to tap the funds that are going to be raised in Scotland. We estimate the apprenticeship levy will generate about £12 to £15 million from the Scottish retail industry. A number of retailers are obviously just focused their operations in Scotland. So they will pay the levy, but not necessarily benefit from it under the current envisaged arrangements. So allowing that to happen would be a huge step forward.
Thank you. And do any of our other guests want to come in on the apprenticeship levy issue. Yes, Gareth Williams.
Thank you. I think it's important to say that we've got a very strong apprenticeship model in Scotland, and we want to protect the quality of that model and not just go for a volume approach. So that's an important consideration for us in the design of any new support. We think that there is scope to increase the number of apprenticeship starts to 30,000 in line with what the Scottish Government has got planned. We welcome the increased diversity of apprenticeships that are being made available as well. We have some strong concerns about lack of clarity, which has already been touched on in terms of how the apprenticeship levy was announced, and continue concern around the details that of how it will operate. And there are some specific concerns in terms of those sectors that are already making industry contributions towards training, so construction sector, for example, and how the apprenticeship levy will operate alongside those sectoral levies. The points that that David has made are ones that we would certainly agree with, and you know, there are concerns not only within big business but public sector, universities and colleges and so on, about how they can benefit from the money that they will be paying towards the apprenticeship levy. So encourage the UK and Scottish governments to consider a delay in the introduction, and then how best the additional funding that will be generated can support the needs of businesses and others in relation to apprenticeships and wider skills needs.
Thank you. I think Mary Tunby wanted to come in at that point.
Thank you. I guess the point that I wanted to make was that our latest education and skills survey has found that 79% of the Scottish businesses we work with participate in apprenticeship training schemes in some form. So apprenticeships is a hugely important part of the skills investments that companies make. But in terms of the apprenticeship levy, I think there are some concerns there that have been pointed out by previous witnesses. But what we've been looking at in terms of our contributions to the government on this is to find solutions for how we implement what is quite a tricky policy. We've said to them that the Scottish Government should treat it as a skills levy rather than an apprenticeship levy, because whereas apprenticeships are an important part of the skills investments companies need, it's not the only one. And what we're seeing is that changing demand and global competition means that there's a huge demand for reskilling of the workforce and helping people who are already part of the staff. So what we're asking for is treating the apprenticeship levy as a skills levy, meaning that you give employers direct access to the funds, but with the flexibility of continuing to invest in skills in a broader sense. So that includes apprenticeships as well as your existing workforce. And additional flexibility that would be welcome would be to expand the age range for apprentices to give companies more flexibility to expand their offer. And then in terms of the kind of broader look at it, we would say that we need to look at the cross-border arrangements and making sure that companies who have operations here in Scotland but are headquartered elsewhere have the opportunity to use their levy funds that they get returned in Scotland if they deem that necessary. And what we would also say is that we need to also make sure that the levy systems across the devolved nations, Wales, Northern Ireland, Scotland, as well as England, are in talk to each other and can actually communicate, and that's based on transparency, collaboration and consistency to help as much as we can the continued skills investments.
Thank you. Graham Jones, did you want to come in on that?
I would just really sort of add my support to what Mary said and to David. I don't think I have anything more I can add beyond it. You've articulated extremely well.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Convener. I have two questions, principally the first to David Lonsdale, who spoke earlier on about the large business supplement potentially having a negative impact on the sector. I understand that the large business supplement might add about £62 million to business rates bills. I just wondered if you could give us more details of that and if anyone else had any input, and also whether there were any thoughts on the abolition of empty buildings relief. My second question is directly to David Williamson of the Scotch Whisky Association. Just, I have in my mind that there was a mushrooming of craft ale industry as a result of a tax break given by Gordon Brown, I think, 10 years ago or so. Is that something that we should be looking at for your sector to encourage? You were speaking earlier about encouraging craft distillers, if you like. Is that something we can be doing?
Thank you for that question. I mean, our we have a broader challenge with the business rates and system in Scotland, and there are sort of two aspects to that. One is essentially, you know, it doesn't reflect economic and trading conditions in the country. So essentially, bills get ratcheted up every year, regardless of whether the economy is doing well or it's doing less well. And we've seen that through the recession in the last sort of economic cycle. So those are the sort of two aspects to it. It doesn't reflect the economy, and bills keep rising. So in that context, you know, the introduction of the large business supplement, unsurprisingly, doesn't help. It sort of adds to the burden. Our estimate is that the rates bill will cost the retail industry in Scotland about an extra £15 million a year on top of the 700 or so million pounds contribution from the sector. And that's within a context where, you know, retail sales have been flat over the last 12 months at best, and that's when you factor in shop prices were actually falling at the moment. So it is an issue. There's profound structural change. People don't really have a tremendous amount of money at the moment. And at the same time, costs like this are rising. So it's certainly front and centre for our industry at the moment. And that's why we were one of 13 organisations that earlier this month wrote to the Finance Secretary saying this is a common issue across all of our sectors and business organisations and memberships, and I guess a plea for him to try and take some action on his budget when it comes up in a couple of months' time.
I think before we go to David Williamson, I think Gil Patterson had a question on that to David Lonsdale.
It's a general one on rates that impacts on his members, so... you know,
well, perhaps we could take that now, and then we'll go to David Williamson for...
I wonder if there's any research. I think the small business bonus came about because of difficulties in the recession. And so it was aimed at small businesses, but I wondered if there has been any research into the impact of that. For instance, retention in shop property and shopping centres, number one, and how the buying power of small businesses then extend into bigger businesses. Because the one thing about small businesses, they tend to buy locally all the services, plumbers, joiners, you know, any lawyers, etc. So I'm wondering if any research has been done into that, how it actually helped big business.
My understanding is the Scottish Government have a couple of times commissioned external research into the small firms bonus, the small firms rates relief scheme. I'm not across that particular aspect of it, but we are supportive of the small firms relief for this very simple reason. It's an implicit acknowledgement that business rates and other costs are an issue for business. We think it just, it's an issue for all businesses. So, you know, we've been supportive of that. The Scottish Government have commissioned this review of rates under Ken Barclay. We are engaging with him at the moment. We'll put in submission to that. We're looking for the changes that I outlined, you know, a few moments ago. But it is an issue for industries, not just in retail. As I say, we pay about a quarter of all business rates, but it's, my experience is it's one that permeates many, many sectors of the economy.
Thank you. And perhaps we can go back to David Williamson on the earlier point.
Okay, thank you. I've been in the industry, the Scotch whisky industry, nearly 20 years, and I can't remember a more interesting time in terms of the number of new distilleries that are being opened across the country. Just last week, there was two new distilleries announced, one in Speyside, one in Islay. Over the last 3 years, there's been over 10 new distilleries opened. And going by conversations across the industry, we reckon there's around another 40 new distilleries being planned and are at different stages of development. And to give you some sort of sense of why that's important, you only need another five or six distilleries to open in Scotland for us to reach a post-war record high in terms of distilleries. So there's a very exciting trend of new small distillers coming into the sector who face high barriers to entry into our market. I mean, you have to lay down stock for at least 3 years before it's even Scotch whisky. You'll be maturing it for significantly longer than that before you sell it, you know, either as a single malt or blend it. And so looking at different ways to support that part of the industry is very important as companies are investing. I've no doubt we'll be talking a lot about the challenges of Brexit during this session, so I'll hold my fire on that. But what we've tried to do within the industry since June is also look at where there may be potential opportunities. And your question around taxation and small distillers is an area where there is the potential for an opportunity. Currently, there is EU legislation that restricts what member states are able to do in terms of offering reduced tax rates to smaller distillers. The Directive 9283 allows for member states to apply a reduced rate of up to 50% on production up to 10 hectolitres of pure alcohol. That's not very much. And at the moment, the certainly over the years, the UK government has not availed itself of that particular mechanism. So there is the potential for the future to take a different approach should government choose to do that. And I think our starting point as an industry would be we campaign around the world for fair and equal taxation of Scotch whisky, making sure there's no discrimination. If we could put in place a system that offered a reduced rates to distillers up to a certain production threshold, but which applied to all up to that threshold, there may be an opportunity both to support new small entrants into the industry at the same time as maintaining that very important principle of non-discrimination and taxation, which the industry argues, you know, strongly for in markets around the world. So at the moment, we couldn't. Because of the framework in which tax policy is set. But for further down the line, this might be one of those areas. I've got many challenges I can outline in Brexit during the course of this morning, as the committee wishes. But this is perhaps one area where there's an opportunity to look at doing something different that helps to support the wide range of new small starts that are coming into our sector.
Thank you. Mary Tunby wanted to come back in on...
Yeah, it's just a quick point. Mr. Kerr mentioned the empty property relief, which is, the removal of the empty property relief, I should say. I would point to how that does cause a bit of challenge for a lot of commercial properties who may have a presence in different local communities where there is some economic challenge in terms of making things work. And I think we would encourage the government to look at giving local authorities some discretion for working with business to encourage their continued presence in the community, because there's sort of anecdotal mentions of some local authorities being better at reaching out to their local businesses to talk about how they can work through the removal of the relief, but maybe looking at that a bit more systematically might be a way to go to try and help both the local communities and the businesses.
I think David Williamson wanted to come back on that point, possibly Gareth Williams as well.
Thank you, Convener. It was more just a general point in business rates as the subject had been raised. I think we're consulting with our members at the moment in the context of the Barclay review, and I'm not going to prejudge where our members land on that, but certainly there have been issues raised in the past amongst our membership in areas such as individual assessors taking different approaches in different parts of the country and what that might mean for different companies and the tax burden. And also anomalies within the system, for example, around where you have invested in renewables capacity at your distillery, facing a higher burden in terms of business rates than others. And so there's areas there that we're certainly exploring with our members. But I think more generally, as we look at business rates and the tax environment, I think particularly at this time of uncertainty in the economy after the Brexit vote, the very strong message we're getting from our members, small and large at the moment, is making sure that the Scottish tax environment, the Scottish business environment, is at least as competitive as anywhere else in the UK, and ideally more so. And so looking at areas such as business rates is very important in that context. And I suppose when it comes to taxation, whether we're talking about devolved or reserved taxation, looking to make sure that any system that we're putting in place, delivers the revenue that's required, very important, but also is fair, is transparent, and as simple as possible. And you won't be surprised that any representative of the whisky industry coming in front of any committee looks at taxation very carefully in the context of excise duty. An excise duty would fail the test that each of those tests I've just set out. So I think there's an opportunity here to make sure that the country is as competitive as possible, particularly at a time of uncertainty.
Gareth Williams.
I agree with everything that's been said, but I would add to what Mary was saying around empty property. There's a particular issue around speculative development, which obviously is necessary for business growth, and varying treatment of when the tax is applied across different areas, whether that's at the point of the property being complete, or whether it's at the point of it becoming occupied, and we could look at that and try and get a more consistent approach, which is more focused on the point when returns start to be made and the property is occupied.
And John Mason, Deputy Convener.
Subject, I don't know if.
Does anyone want to come back in on the issues that have just been discussed? Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. I was interested, David, in your point about non-domestic rating. Given that it's a levy on rent and not a levy on turnover, if the economic conditions are deteriorating, should rents not fall and therefore non-domestic rating fall? Why are they not falling?
Well, we've got a revaluation coming up, but it's 7 or 8 years after the last revaluation. I think you and I may have touched on some of this when you were on the commission last year on local tax reform. But one of our challenges with the rate system, of course, is it doesn't flex with economic conditions. One option for that is to have more regular revaluations, and therefore might better reflect economic circumstances. And so that might be one aspect. In terms of rents, the structure. That's a sort of an issue, particularly in and around commercial property and landlords and things. And obviously, the structure of some leases or many leases are often on an upwards only rent basis. So there are sort of profound sort of structural changes and issues in that particular aspect which knock on. But the reality is the business rate poundage is effectively ratcheted up every year. And that is obviously causing issues. And then when you have things like the large business supplement on top,
That makes it more challenging. I guess all that comes at a time when retailers in particular have options as to where they invest, whether that's in physical stores or an online presence.
But they, in an ideal world, rent should fall if economic conditions are deteriorating.
Well, we'll see what happens and comes out of the revaluation coming up in due course. As I say, we haven't had one for 7 or 8 years. So at the moment, retailers and indeed every firm in Scotland is paying a business rate based on conditions effectively at the top of the market in the beginning of 2008 from 7, 8 years ago. So that is the reality at the moment. Firms have been paying that. They've been asked to pay every year more. And then obviously we've had the large business supplement we were talking about a moment ago on top of that. I think if I may just quickly touch on David Williamson's point, convener. My plea today, as I understand it, this is to sort of influence the committee's work programme. And I think David made an excellent point that the Finance Committee, and I appreciate there are other people on this committee who are on the Finance Committee, the Finance Committee's job is to look at taxes. And obviously, are they sound? Are they going to generate the revenues and things like that? From our perspective, we would like this committee to obviously take an interest in, is it the right thing for the economy, whether that's business taxes or personal taxes, which are obviously now the preserve of this parliament and government as well. So that's where we think this committee can add its weight. So for example, whether it's on the small firms, rich relief, or the large business supplement, is there an economic dynamic behind it and has been explored, or is it simply some sort of cash aspect to it, revenue raising aspect to it?
Thank you. I think Gordon MacDonald, committee member, wanted to come in on that.
It's on the same subject. We touched upon the possibility of the removal of empty property relief. I'm just wondering what we would put in its place. I know certainly in my constituency, there is a large supermarket site that's remained empty for 10 years. And the concern within the community is that it's a deliberate policy in order to stop competition, i.e. a competitor taking over the site. So when there's so much pressure on Greenbelt sites in Edinburgh to build housing, and you have a large site that's remained empty for over 10 years, what mechanism should be put in place in order to encourage development if it isn't the removal of empty property relief?
Any ideas on that, David?
Empty property relief isn't something we've touched on. We produced a budget submission for the Finance Secretary a few weeks ago, and it covers all the sort of priority issues for our industry. But there's a very simple reason why we didn't alight on empty property rates relief, and it goes to that, I guess, the heart of your question, which is the retail industry is in a pretty difficult position, and it has been now for a number of years. Retail sales have been flat for the last few years. There aren't that many retail businesses that are expanding their footprint. In fact, as I said earlier on, there's actually been a retrenchment. So there's been about 1,700 fewer shops in Scotland over the last 6 or 7 years, according to Scottish Government statistics. And our indications and our forecasts are that will actually continue. We'd love to be in a position where there are people and companies.
My concern is where you have a supermarket that's traded in an area for a number of years, and it moves a mile and a half down the road to new premises, and then doesn't sell off the old piece of land, either because it doesn't want a competitor in its back door, or it's just land banking for the future.
It's difficult to comment, obviously, on specific cases. I don't, most, given the discussions that we have with most of our members, they bite your hand off for money, whether that's income from receipts from capital, selling capital assets. So there may well be something in what you say, but most of them, the fact is, in terms of grocery market, the market's changing. People are buying online. They're getting groceries delivered to their house. People aren't really, there are one or two retailers in the grocery sector who are picking up large properties, but actually the vast majority of most grocery retailers aren't developing huge new estates. The market's fundamentally changed. We're buying online. I think we talked earlier on about the end of the weekly shop, in a sense. People are using convenience, purchasing more often. The
the market has completely and utterly changed. So the idea that another grocer is going to come along and take over a huge superstore, it's going to be much less common than it was before. Obviously, I can't comment on particular cases. I don't know that particular one, but most companies in our sector would be delighted to try and offload assets, frankly. So I don't know if anyone's been in to make a bid, whether there's, you know, change of use allowed around the planning regime.
Mary Tunby, did you want to make a point?
Yeah,
on this?
It was just it's obviously not a silver bullet in any way, but I would reiterate the point of the importance of giving local authorities the discretion and flexibility to have those sorts of conversations with the businesses who are based in their area to try and work out solutions that are mutually beneficial when it comes to sites or properties that they are struggling with, because there'll be multiple reasons for that, and that's I think a valuable conversation to have. While we're on the subject of business rates, I guess I'll just like to reiterate the point in terms of when we are looking at the business rates review and business rates more broadly, we would say that it is incredibly important to find ways of better reflecting economic realities in the rate system. And as we're working on the sort of solutions for how we can at least move in that direction, in consultation with our members, as well as to the Barclay Review, we would say that it's important to find ways of slowing down the fast increases in the business rates multiplier. One way would be to index the multiplier against CPI rather than RPI. But we're also, a point that was touched on by David from Scotch Whisky Association earlier was, what do we do about plant and machinery and productive investments that companies are making in terms of maybe mainly environmental efficiency? We would say that new investments should be exempted from business rates. And what we would also encourage is more frequent valuation in business rates. So one way is to value Scottish properties every 3 years. Which would address some of those challenges that we see in the system today.
Would revaluing every 3 years not also introduce uncertainty, though? Because if businesses know what the rates are, perhaps for a longer period of time, even 10 years, at least they know precisely more or less where they're at.
But I think that the rates hikes that you might see from the more infrequent valuations will then be addressed in a way, because there is a smaller incremental rise with a three-year revaluation.
Yeah, it's easier to plan for. Thank you. John Mason.
Me. Okay, different subject. Brexit got mentioned already by one of the witnesses, but that was what I wanted to ask about. And, I mean, I suppose quite a short question. I mean, I'd be interested in each witness if they could give us what they saw as one threat, one opportunity. And I mean, this committee has the opportunity to feed back to the Scottish Government and the Westminster Government about how they should be negotiating over Brexit. So is there anything in there that you think we should be pushing for from the two governments?
David Williamson.
Having raised the subject originally, John, I'm happy to field it. I mean, I think the Scotch whisky industry argued strongly for the UK to remain in the European Union, and we did so for a number of reasons, which are worth reflecting on now as we look ahead. And that is, a third of our exports go to the European single market, and so retaining the best possible access to and influence within that single market is very important to our members. Just to give you a sense of, you know, once you scratch away at the surface, what this means, the size of the bottle we sell our whiskey in, the label we put on that bottle, and the definition of our product that goes in the bottle are all set at European level. And so we've had the opportunity in the past to be part of discussions around those very fundamental issues for us, retaining that ability to have influence and be able to discuss very key issues for us is really, really important. We also argued strongly that the Scotch whisky industry has done very well out of the EU's trade deals around the world over the years, reduced tariffs, removal of discrimination, protection of the Scotch whisky, geographical indication. And there are questions now and uncertainties around how we maintain those benefits going forward. I think for us, looking at...
So on that point, if you say the EU has a deal with Australia and we are part of that, what's your fear that if we leave the EU, or we are leaving the EU, we have effectively have no deal with Australia?
It depends on the country, so it's hard just to pick on one market. In principle, it's going to depend, of course, on which model we decide to negotiate on with the rest of the EU for the future relationship. For us, taking on your challenges, where are the priorities? And it's an answer to your second question. On the trade side, absolutely fundamental that we grandfather or maintain the existing benefits that the Scotch whisky industry has secured through previous trade deals. So it will depend on the market, but there are, in some markets, the challenge would be tariffs going back up, the protection we've secured for Scotch whisky in that market falling. Now, we think we can manage that as an industry through a variety of different ways, depending on the market. But a top priority at the moment in our discussions with UK government and the Scottish government is to make sure that what we have secured over the years, which has helped to grow Scotch whisky exports around the world, we maintain at the very least. And then we can have a separate discussion about what sort of trade deals we want to prioritise going forward. And that's a piece of work we've been doing over the summer, and we'd be more than happy to share our analysis with the committee in writing if it would be helpful. But there'd be no surprises that a top priority for the future would be some sort of trade deal with India, which could be a massive opportunity for the Scotch whisky industry. We've currently got 1% market share, but we face a 150% tariff. You remove that or reduce that significantly, that would be transformational for the Scotch whisky industry in terms of the opportunity. I think one other point I just want to make, and I think it's an important one for the wider Scottish food and drink industry, is the Scotch whisky geographical indication is well protected. We're very active in that as a sector. We have domestic legislation that protects Scotch, as well as the geographical indication being protected at European level. Other Scottish food and drinks products need to look very carefully now at how they secure their protected denominations, because they've relied on European legislation to date. They don't have domestic legislation in place, and making sure that the intellectual property around these different food and drink products from Scotland is going to be really important going forward. And we're working with a number of organisations to look at what the mechanisms might be to do that, but it shouldn't fall away from sight just because it's quite a technical issue. Protecting the intellectual property around Scottish food and drink products in the future is really, really important.
Thank you. I think Ash Denham wanted to come in on this point.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, it was a point specifically about financial services, which obviously is a large sector for Scotland. It's a large sector in the City of Edinburgh. And obviously, as we've just heard, we don't know what model precisely we may end up with at the end of Brexit, what will end up being negotiated. But I understand that several of these models will particularly impact the trading of services. And I wonder if you could explain a little bit about what the implications for financial services in Scotland might be of that type of Brexit arrangement.
Thank you. I think, Ash, what you're probably alluding to here is passporting. So what passporting is it means that a bank or an asset manager or an asset servicer or a wealth manager or anything in between or an investment bank can manufacture, if you like, its product, whatever it is, whether it's a mergers and acquisition, a deal or whatever it is that they're doing, or it could be our legal profession and accountancy profession who are involved in similar. But it allows us essentially to trade those services across European borders effortlessly. So at the present moment in time, Article 50 has not been invoked. It's a bit of a phony war just now, so that as far as we're concerned, we're trading as normal. But our asset management sector in Scotland is second only to the City of London in scale. £880 billion of funds under management.
If we were to lose passporting, that is something that the asset management sector would not want. So very, very similar to what David has been saying. What we want is, what we would have preferred, would have to remain in EU. Very clear, that is what our members would have preferred. On the basis that we're coming out of the EU, we need the next best proxy to the existing EU agreements that we've got. So from our point of view, it is very, very important that passporting rights are protected. Now, there's a further observation which I would make, which David was alluding to, and that is the level of complexity on the path that we have chosen and we're embarking upon. Does anybody in the committee here know how many regulations, EU regulations, there are in banking and finance so far? 8,000 and counting. 8,000 and counting. Do any of you know how many trade agreements that banking and financial services enjoy where the EU agreement is the primary agreement? 35. So how this is unpicked for us is very, very, very important, because the devil here will be in the detail. And if you look at the operating models of the companies that we've got, it's very, very diverse. So we've got something like 100 members, and all of them have very different operating models. So some of our banks are R&D tech centres for global banks, and they would be by and large unaffected by it. Some of our members who have got operating models that absolutely have integral to the underlying operating model, passporting, would be hugely affected. So it's not just a case of it's complicated, it's also the fact that it affects how it impacts organisations will be at individual level, even if they are in a common sector. So that hopefully gives you a flavour for what we're contending with. But we're being very, very clear when we consult with government that we would prefer to have the best possible deal that we can have with the EU. We think that's essential.
On the point you make about regulations, I understand the point you're making, but of course many regulations or EU rules are enacted as British laws or regulations, whether at the Scottish or the Westminster level. So they won't be affected in the sense that they remain law until and if they are changed at UK level. Is that not correct?
Yes. Well, I think there's a couple of things just to add to that. Is you could adopt them all, so you could, as you say, you just say we'll adopt them. But once we exit, you could have divergence. And in fact, it would happen through time. It wouldn't happen immediately, but through time, you can have different capital adequacy rules. But the danger we're faced with, because there was a debate I was part to, where somebody said, wouldn't it be really good if we could relax some of the regulation around banking finance? But the reality of the situation is, if we want to have access to the European market, when they're negotiating with us, will demand equivalency. So what we don't end up being in Scottish banking financial services or the UK banking financial services is a rule taker. It's very, very important. At the moment just now, yes, we are part of the rules, but we have a seat at the top table. So when we're negotiating things such as capital adequacy calcs, we're actually there. Whereas the danger that we would run is being a rule taker. So we have to take the rules that are being provided from Europe, but we have no say or influence over them.
I think if we could just perhaps move on from that. Gillian Martin wanted to come in.
Yeah, moving on to the work of the Fair Work Conventions woven throughout the recent Scottish Government labour market strategy. And my question to our witnesses here today is how that's informing the operations of big business, but particularly what work's been done by business and your members that you represent to identify and address the gender pay gap.
Mary Tunby.
So I know that there is currently work ongoing in the CBI on the gender pay gap and gender pay reporting. I think it's still being developed, so as soon as I have that, I'm happy to share that with the committee.
Gareth Williams.
Yeah, and I think there's work on a sectoral basis within Scotland. So, for example, the Law Society of Scotland have been looking at some of those issues. And from our perspective, we think that's the right approach. We think businesses and sectors are increasingly aware of those issues and the long-term implications for them in relation to attraction, retention of talent within their businesses. And we want to see the Fair Work Convention and government and industry working together positively to address them. I think the labour market strategy is the basis for those conversations. There's not a whole lot new in that, and I think the most significant point is the creation of a strategic ministerial group. But if that's to lead to further input of expertise and raising awareness, not only in larger businesses, but as importantly, all levels of business, then that's something that that we would support.
I'm just wondering, Eric Geddes has not been involved in the discussion. I'm just wondering if you wanted to comment on that most recent question or indeed any of the other issues that have come up thus far.
Yeah, I think it's probably more relevant to go back to Brexit, if that's okay. I think it's such a big overriding issue, something we'd be keen to state where we're at with it. Very much agreed with what David Williamson said, in the sense that it was... it's about competitiveness and making Scotland as competitive as possible, which is vital because while we supported the Remain campaign, we are where we are and we're confident that Edinburgh Airport can continue to grow as a business in spite of that result and indeed any other constitutional changes which may happen. But we're aware of industry concerns of leaving Europe and the knock-on effect that that may have, so we're monitoring it very closely. If I can bring it on to air passenger duty for a second, we feel that the cut to APD is a real opportunity to mitigate uncertainty and risk that comes with Brexit. It sends a signal to Europe and indeed to the whole world that Scotland is open for business and competitive. And it's an opportunity that will help big businesses and small businesses, and the knock-on effect will be good for all of Scotland.
Mary Tunby, you wanted to come back on that?
Yeah, I was just there. I wanted to come in on that point in terms of Brexit and the importance of sending signals in terms of our competitiveness. And just, I think an important point for all politicians will be to send a clear signal of openness. I think... In purely practical terms, we would say that we need a clear timetable and a plan for the UK-EU negotiations, and we also need close partnership between business and the Scottish Government, business and the UK Government, and between the Scottish and the UK Governments themselves. Because I think an important point for us is... the implications of leaving the EU on all the nations of the United Kingdom needs to be understood by those who are around the negotiating table. And I think all of us need to give a clear message out there that we remain open for business, we still want to attract investment, we still want to attract skills. We still want to keep trading. So I think those are kind of immediate priorities as we wait for the framework of the negotiations from the UK government.
If I can just reiterate that a second as well, I guess to give it some context why we're banging on about APD so much at the airport and indeed across the industry. Independently prepared calculations by Bigger Economics show that a 50% cut in one move to air passenger duty will mean an additional 18 million passengers coming to Scotland between the detail of the move and the next 5 years, so potentially up to 2021, 22. That'll create 10,000 new jobs in Scotland in tourism and related sectors.
and add more than 300 million GVA per year to the Scottish economy.
May I ask what these figures are based on in terms of the increased passenger numbers? They are indeed. They're based on, and also, sorry, where are the passengers coming from? Are these going to be new people coming to the United Kingdom as such, or passengers coming to Scotland rather than going to London, say?
It would be, no, they'd be passengers coming to Scotland.
Well, so, sorry.
Passengers using Scottish airports, excuse me. But the biggest growth area in aviation, particularly at Edinburgh Airport, is international passengers. So while there's opportunities for people to go on holiday, and that's well documented, the great gain of cutting APD is inward investment and the ability of not the 6 million people in Scotland, but the 7 billion people across the world to come here. So that will create jobs. The knock-on effect of that will create greater wealth and opportunities for the Scottish economy.
So perhaps my question was not clearly enough phrased. The increase in international passengers, does that mean a total net increase for the United Kingdom, or is that some passengers choosing to come to Scotland rather than fly through London, for example?
To come to Scotland. The great gain of cutting APD in Scotland is it gives Scotland a competitive edge. And that will attract, the same way that Dublin Airport attracts much more passengers than any airport in Scotland, passengers direct to Scotland. If you're an EasyJet or a Ryanair and you're looking at setting out new routes, one of your key factors is desirability, but also the cost to fly there. Scotland is disproportionately further away, so there's more fuel costs, and it's more expensive to land planes there, and because of the APD cost as well, airlines are less attracted to come here. You take that away, you make Scotland more competitive.
And are these transit passengers who then just fly on somewhere else, or ones that remain in Scotland and do business here?
I guess further down the line, there is hopefully opportunities for us to have a hub airport, but at the moment, people are coming to Scotland. People are coming to Scotland because it's a great country to come to and visit, to do business here, for universities, to drink whisky. It's an attractive prospect, but it's disincentivised by APD. You take that away, you attract more people.
David Williamson.
I just wanted to follow up very quickly on a point Mary made and also respond to Gillian, if I may. One was open markets really do matter to the Scottish economy, and as we look at Brexit, you know, ensuring that open trading policy, but also that we have pragmatic, non-disruptive transitional arrangements, really, really important. And that's a big message that anybody in Scotland can take out as we you know, move that negotiation forward. I think a starting point would be making sure that the EU legislation that is in place is transposed in UK law, so that we have that certainty, at least for an interim basis, and then it's up to politicians to decide to what extent that legislation either stays in place or there's a different approach taken in the future. Turning just very quickly to Gillian's point, I think there would be a perception of my industry that it's a male-dominated industry, but I think the industry is working very hard on that. Certainly at our AGM this year, there was a focus on, you know, getting women into leadership roles within our sector, a work in progress, but something where there's a very clear focus on within the industry. Certainly a significant number of the new master distillers and master blenders in our sector are women who've been coming into the industry from different paths. I think that the final point in this area is just to say that there's a role here for the business pledge that we haven't touched on this morning, which is that, you know, it's up to individual companies to decide whether that's the right way for them to go. When you look at the considerations around internationalisation, innovation, you know, youth workforce, a balanced workplace, the sort of elements that are in there, I think our industry would measure up well in any of those. But there's an area for the likes trade associations like ourselves to keep growing awareness of that, and then companies can take that forward.
Forgive me for skipping around, but I probably should. You did ask me about Gillian's point as well, and Edinburgh Airport has signed up to the Scottish Business Pledge and would broadly support moves for greater gender equality in the sector and beyond.
Thank you. David Lonsdale.
Just two quick points. I didn't reacquaint myself with our submission and paper on gender pay, but I'm happy to share that with Gillian Martin and indeed the committee later today. So we do have a position on it. I simply can't remember off the top of my head, I'm afraid. I'm sure it's very progressive, though. But very I'll stop digging. No, I believe it is. But the other point on segueing on to Brexit, in the document I did bring today, and I do have in front of me our budget submission to the Scottish Government, we made two points, and this, I guess, goes back to John Mason's point about the opportunity. The first was, as I understand it, we're obviously leaving the EU. Control of our powers will be repatriated, but not all of them will necessarily go to Westminster. Some may come to this Parliament and also some of the other devolved assemblies in the UK. So our recommendation in the paper is let's get a handle on that and get a sense from government and Parliament here in Scotland as to what they would do with those powers going forward. And secondly, somebody put it to me recently in light of Brexit, don't waste a good crisis. So from our perspective, you know, are there things that the Scottish Government can do to improve the business environment here in Scotland? And obviously we've set out some of those and we've talked about some of them today.
Just for the record, what is that paper called that you're referring to? What's the...
I won't give you the full Sunday name, it's quite long, but it's called Open for Business. Happy to share it with the clerk.
It's just for the written record so that people know what we're referring to specifically. If I might come to Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, convener. Just some follow-up questions for our guests, and thank you very much for coming along this morning. First one for Eric Geddes. In terms of what you're seeing post-Brexit in terms of inward-bound tourism to Scotland, we've heard from different bodies that they've seen an increase, partly due to depreciation of sterling as well as other factors. I'll give you a couple of seconds to think about that. David Williamson on whiskey and food and drink more generally. Again, looking at the opportunities post-Brexit, can you talk us through what might be the international export opportunities? I believe you mentioned India. I believe exports to India are up 40% in the first 6 months of this year. The depreciation of sterling against the Japanese yen, one of the fastest growing whisky markets, has been quite significant, so perhaps there will be opportunities there. And finally, a question for Graham Jones. Graham, we spoke earlier about the financial services industry in Scotland contributing about 10% to GDP. Can you very briefly talk us through how the industry is preparing for fintech opportunities, and how critical is it for Scotland's financial services industry and investors to have a central bank, a lender of last resort, with sufficient reserves to underpin the sector?
The immediate effect being one of on currency has not been problematic for us. We would have expected to see good passenger numbers in July and August anyway, and we did. And I guess the overall point is that regardless of the vote to leave the EU, we remain confident that Edinburgh Airport will continue to thrive and grow as a business. However, there are airline concerns. Two of our big airlines have made noises that they're very unsatisfied with what this will mean to aviation in the UK, and indeed US services have potentially talked about withdrawals from the UK as well. So we're monitoring it very closely. I guess more will become obvious as we approach Article 50, but there's been no negative impact, particularly since it's happened earlier in the summer.
Thank you. Yes, maybe just prefacing the answer by just talking very quickly about the conditions we're facing in the market anyway. The Scotch whisky industry has had a 10-20-year period of growth in terms of value and volume of exports. Certainly over the last 2 years, it has become much more difficult in a range of markets for many reasons. And so that export success can't be taken for granted. So our starting point on Brexit is certainly one of uncertainty and challenge for the reasons I outlined earlier. But in terms of looking further ahead, and we're a long-term industry, so we've done a lot of thinking already about the trading environment and markets around the world going forward. I think the challenge for us and the opportunity, therefore, is that there are trade deals revisited or struck for the first time with markets with the biggest potential commercial opportunity for Scotch whisky going forward. Now, you've already mentioned India, that would certainly be the industry's top international trade priority, given the current challenges we face because of the tariff to get into the market, but also the growth opportunity once you're there. Looking more widely, though, I think this is an area where the industry sees real opportunity. Are markets that are perhaps not front of mind for the wider economy? That's markets in Latin America, where we're seeing growth for Scotch whisky already, but where there's real space to grow in the future. I'm thinking of markets like Mexico and Brazil. There's a lot of industry interest at the moment in, over the next 10 years, how sub-Saharan African markets are going to grow for Scotch whisky. Markets like Nigeria, Ghana, Kenya, where you're seeing, you know, economies that are developing with consumers who want to buy aspirational products like Scotch whisky. I think in Southeast Asia, markets like Vietnam are seen as being potentially very important for Scotch whisky in the future. What you're seeing in all of those markets is aspirational consumers who, as they have more disposable income, are wanting to make a statement about how the economy is growing and how they are doing personally. So in the same way that you might buy a nice watch or a nice handbag, Scotch whisky is seen as being a desirable but affordable luxury product. And so the opportunity is there, but the challenge is making sure that in this post-Brexit vote environment, the trade deals that are struck prioritise products like Scotch whisky going forward. I suppose a final point, if I may, just the challenge for the wider Scottish food and drink sector. I think the same applies. I mean, the Scottish food and drink sector is looking at exports in terms of, you know, provenance, authenticity, heritage, high quality. The industry, the Scotch whisky industry and the wider sector are working together now in an export collaboration initiative to make sure that we take full advantage of those opportunities. And where Scotch already has networks or experience in a market, the wider sector can try and benefit as a result of that.
Can I just ask you what the second point was that you gave me in your three-part question, please? I managed to get the first and the last.
It was the importance of the central bank with sufficient reserves to underpin confidence in the banking sector and international investors who invest into the Scottish banking sector.
Thank you. Okay, so can I start with financial technology, or fintech, as the sort of as it's more widely called? And I think it might be worth me giving just a quick description of what financial technology is. So technology has been applied in banks since, you know, post the Second World War, and typically it was the large mainframes that sat in heated bunkers, or cool bunkers, should I say, and people didn't really access the technology other than the programmers. And when I started working in banking finance in 1980, that was the case. There were no terminals on people's desks, there were no laptops, no computers, PDAs or mobile phones. Somehow we coped. But the thing I would say about financial technology, which is very important today, it is the digitization of banking processes, every banking process you can think of, either through blockchain, artificial intelligence, robo-advice. It is a global phenomenon. It's happening now to our organizations, and you cannot control it because it's a global phenomenon. Someone somewhere in Manila right now might be writing a program that does away with the BACS and CHAPS system, the bank automated clearing system, and the check clearing system. For all we know, somebody could be doing that today. It is also likely to be a non-banking person. It's probably likely to be someone who's a PhD student who thinks, I think I'd like to try and do something with my life, and I want to go and try and invent something in the financial technology space. And when these organizations, when they actually do something, they get it right, they become what's called unicorns, billion-pound companies. And what is typical for most developed countries is that they have a fintech hub, a financial technology hub. So in the US, they've got one in California, and they've got one in New York City. Germany have the factory, you can Google it, which is based in Berlin. Stockholm and Copenhagen have declared to their governments their intent to become financial technology hubs, because it's associated with a brand of smart, savvy, cool people capable of transformational change and innovation. So it's a halo effect brand for the country. And it attracts other organizations in who are smart and savvy, say, well, I actually want to go into that country because that's a good landing point for me, because I can come in there and I can tap into that intellectual property. So from a Scotland perspective, we are incredibly well placed incredibly well placed, because first component you need is a diverse financial services sector. Second only to the City of London, we're it. We are in a different league from Leeds or from Manchester. Now, because I've been in banking for so long, 38 years I've been in banking financial services, I know the sector. If you go down into Leeds, which is going to be the, one of the northern powerhouse towns, they have two building society groups. So all their financial technology is aimed at mortgage origination, because that's what they've got to deal with. If you look at Scotland, we have got asset management, asset servicing, wealth management, independent financial advisory, retail banking, corporate banking, investment banking, merchant banking. We have a fantastic legal profession that goes across and supports all of these businesses, and we have got fantastic accountancy profession. So if you imagine it as a cake, if you like, the FinTech Hub cake, we have all the ingredients to make that cake, but we must put it together. Otherwise, all that will happen is we it'll still continue as it is, but we'll just never leverage the position and we won't achieve true potential. Now, for Scotland's large banking institutions and asset management institutions, we've got to win this battle, simple as, because we are competing in a global marketplace, and it's one of these things where either we do it to them, so we come up with the smart fintech apps and export them, and there's upside here for Scotland if we get good at this. We export our technology, we export our applications across the globe, or we wait for someone in Dublin to do it to us. So the big message from SFE and the members is we want to be off the front foot, we want to be proactive here, and we want to make sure that we have a fintech hub that serves two purposes. One, it protects the back book, 226,000 jobs. And that's probably at the light end of what the sector has. So job number one, which we are doing for our members, is saying, how do we protect the 226,000 jobs? Job number two, how do we get more jobs to Scotland? And I think that the universities that we have, the quality of the students, the quality of the education system, and the quality of the country in terms of transport and ease of access makes it a very, very attractive place for foreign investors to come, or even companies that might be based down in London, fintech companies based in London, saying, well, actually, my next biggest market is Edinburgh, Glasgow. So that's a quick sort of snapshot on fintech. But we are hugely excited by it. We have in our agenda for FISAB on the 4th of October as one of two major agenda items. So we're working very closely with our partners, which are Scottish Enterprise and Deloitte.
Thank you. Richard Leonard.
Thanks, Convener. I think I'm looking for illumination on two points, and one has been covered already, and that's trade agreements. But I just want to understand a bit better. I think, Graham, you mentioned that there were 35 trade agreements struck through the European Union that affected your sector. I mean, what kind of proportions are we talking about here? Are nearly all the agreements that we're party to now under the umbrella of the European Union? And to the extent that's, if that's the case, what's the implication of Brexit? Does that mean we have to renegotiate all of those agreements, or is there a way of ensuring continuity? Because I mean, my understanding is trade agreements can run to thousands of pages long and can take years and years. I'm looking at David, it can take years and years to conclude. So I just want to understand better where we are then and where you think we're likely to be on trade agreements. And my second point of illumination is really just to ask whether you are aware of whether any of your members are considering relocating overseas as a contingency plan.
Will I open the batting? Would that be okay?
Please do.
So I don't actually know. The work has started. The work has just started to figure out these things, because I think the fact that we left was a bit of a surprise all round. So that process is started of beginning to understand how we are linked to it. I understand, and you know, please don't take this as read, but I understand that our main agreement with China is through the EU. Now, I don't know how long it took to set up, but I would reckon it would be in the order of 10 years or something like that. So if that is the case, that would be something which is part, I think, as David was alluding to, is we don't know what the type of negotiation is that we're going into and what type of negotiation will come out of that. But clearly, those trade agreements and understanding what the linkages are and what the dependencies and interdependencies are really, really important to unpick extremely carefully. And that is why we would want and we would urge, and our members are urging, for the best possible proxy to what we currently have now, so that we protect those agreements as much as we possibly can. But I would imagine that at the other side of the table, the Europeans will be driving a hard bargain, I think. And that's something we have to be mindful of. I spoke to people from Switzerland just, and this might make it come alive for you. It's better sometimes to give examples. The Swiss have 126 bilateral agreements. In the air, they have people, garrisons of people flying around the world maintaining 126 bilateral agreements. The reason why the Swiss banks, like Credit Suisse and UBS, Phillips and Drew are in London, is they sort of said, well, this is a really difficult way to do things, so we'll move our HQs out of Zurich and Bern and Genève, and we'll pop them into London, and guess what? They access their passporting rights that are being located in London. So that is what, that's a practical example. It's public domain. That's what the Swiss have done. But they still have 126 bilateral agreements that they have to maintain. So hopefully it'll give you a feel for what life is like, if you like, outside the tent.
David Williamson.
Convener, I'm afraid, Richard, this has been my life, trade deals and trade policy. And forgive me if I go on for a bit. Simple answer to your first question is yes, because of the EU common commercial policy, our trade, the existing trade deals are all channeled through the European Union, and that is part of the challenge going forward, is setting up the relevant capacity and expertise to negotiate the large number of trade agreements that we're talking about. There are different options. They could be renegotiated as and when the UK leaves the EU, or there may be mechanisms found for some form of continuity. So, for example, if you take the EU-South Korea deal as an example, you could turn that into a tripartite agreement where it's the EU-UK, because there's already terms there that the UK could simply say, we'd like to sign up to that now as the UK rather than as part of the EU. But this takes time and is very, very difficult. I mean, I led for the Scotch Whisky Association on the EU-Canada deal. It took 7 years and it's still not signed off and implemented. You know, it's notoriously difficult to get consensus and agreement on this side of things. I've also been around long enough to have led for us on the EU-Swiss deal, which goes back a number of years. That was inherently complex. Graham's already alluded to the number of different sectoral agreements that had to be struck, including one on wines and spirits. So you have to then get down to the real technical detail and still come out with an agreement at the end of the day. So don't be under any illusions how difficult it would be to get in place either the continuity with current arrangements or indeed to strike more advantageous deals. It's possible, certainly that's the opportunity that we have to now pursue, but it'll be difficult. I think in answer to your second question for Illumination, in terms of relocation, with the Scotch Whisky geographical indication, you can't outsource that production, so I think we'll be staying here. Yeah, I think that's a wider issue, and part of the challenge in our sector is maintaining that investment into the sector across companies that then attracts and creates the cluster that you're able then to produce and bottle white spirits as well in Scotland. And we've done well in that in the past.
Thank you. I think Gordon MacDonald and Andy Whiteman had two further points they wanted to come in, so yeah. Perhaps we could take those two questions now.
Just on the continuation theme of Brexit, if we don't retain the principle of free movement of people with the other EU countries, what impact would that have on your members?
Sorry, Andy Whiteman, perhaps take your question as well. We're finishing up shortly, so perhaps we take these two questions.
Thank you, Convener. My question is for Graham Jones. You talked about protecting 226,000 backroom jobs in the context of financial technology development.
Is it not the case, I mean, I'm just asking because I don't know, that some of this technology, peer-to-peer lending, digital currencies, etc., threaten to demolish large sections of the financial services industry as it's currently constructed?
I think they won't demolish them. The technology requires time to be adopted. So if you think of blockchain development or distributed digital ledgers, that's still many years away, but it will come through time. But as we would say, the time to mend the roof is when the sun's shining, and what it's perfectly able to do is to see what these changes are, understand what the changes are, and then repurpose the staff. So I think, I can't remember who was talking about reskilling or retraining, but the smart thing to do is to say, I can see that this range of more operational jobs is going to go, but there's going to be massive, massive growth in regulatory compliance and dealing with regulation and unpicking all of these agreements which we've been chatting about. So staff would be redeployed to that. So the sort of the view of the SFE members is what will happen is we'll have, you know, we've got 226,000 jobs now. 5 years from now, we'll have 226,000 jobs, but people will be doing different jobs. So instead of maybe counting checks for SMEs in a bank branch, you will be working on the digital app for SMEs for accessing asset finance and trade finance at advantageous rates or whatever. But it does mean that large numbers of people will require to be reskilled and will have to transform. But going back to my time when I started off with no computers, no mobile phones, no laptops, no Microsoft Windows, no Microsoft Excel, I just had to learn it and adapt as I went on. So we are very, very confident that the staff that we have in our large banks and our large financial institutions are more than capable of being reskilled. But that's the deal. If you say, I just want it to stay the way it is, you're absolutely correct. Big swathes of banking would be taken out, but no one's thinking that way. Everyone's saying we need to adapt and we need to reskill as we go, and that's the way that we keep those jobs.
All right, thank you. We'll come back then to Gordon MacDonald's question, perhaps, about freedom of movement of workers. And Mary Tunby, if you want to come in on that, or indeed what has just been said.
Yeah, I thought I'd come in on the point about freedom of movement. I think it'll be challenging, but it will be important that we somehow manage to work towards immigration policy that recognises the need from business to have access to skills wherever they come from, at the same time as having an immigration policy that has the confidence of the people of the United Kingdom. I'd like to make an additional point in terms of European citizens already working here. What we've said there is clearly they're facing a profoundly uncertain future, still waiting to see what the outcome of it is, which is why we've said that the government must confirm that those people who are here already working from the EU, the government needs to confirm that they can stay.
Could I just ask on that last point, which European nations have confirmed that British citizens will be allowed to stay after Brexit, regardless of the agreement reached?
I don't have that answer for you.
I think the answer is none. Is that not correct?
Yeah, but I think we also need to recognise the contribution that those European citizens are making to the UK economy, and the fact that we value them and want them to continue making that contribution to our society and our economy.
Yes, for that may be a different question. Others want to come in on the question that Gordon raised. Gareth Williams.
Yeah, it was to say that this is the number one issue for some sectors, not all sectors. Some sectors are more concerned about single market membership or access to or trade deals and so on, but certainly this is a major issue for some sectors. And it's the range of skills as well. It's the high level skills, but it's also lower level skills. And it's not just business, it's public sector, it's social care, etc. I think we have to recognise that there's a particular demographic challenge for Scotland around our protections of a declining working age population. from the early 2020s, which contrasts with other parts of the UK. And we certainly believe that there should be room for a differentiated approach around immigration to reflect the different needs of the economy, the different demographic issues, the different levels of political support. For example, for the reintroduction of a post-study work visa within Scotland. And we do, you know, tying it into the issues that I raised earlier around productivity, innovation, internationalisation, we have a large number of EU students at our universities. We want them to stay and contribute to the Scottish economy. We have a large number of large percentage of researchers within Scottish universities that come from other parts of the EU. And the last thing that we want to do when we're addressing those long-term challenges is to have an economy which is less open for talent, less open for investment. So yes, we understand the challenge that the government has, the UK government has, around being seen to respond to public concern on this issue. But a way has to be found to ensure that we have access to those skills. And we would hope that that a differentiated position could be found for Scotland.
Any last comments on that point from any of our guests? Right, well, may I thank all of our guests for coming and taking part in this roundtable discussion. And we'll now, I'll suspend the session and we'll move into private session. So that gives our guests an opportunity to leave at this stage. Thank you very much.